Hey there, polar bear, it's quite a mess we found. Life is one heavy trip, our paws are sinking in the ground. See you out lumbering at the break of dawn. How can we survive and save the day before the day is gone? Well, I know I'm gonna find a way. I know I'm gonna light the way. Cause if I'm ever gonna make it, then I gotta say, I can save the world today and every day. Young blood coming up and coming from behind. You know you've got the force to change the world, and it's your mind. Your big plans are shining like the bright waves of the sun. We can't be done when all I see is that you've just begun. Well, I know you're gonna find a way. I know you're gonna light the way. Cause if we're ever gonna make it, then you gotta say, I can save the world today and every day. Some say the small things don't count, some say the big things don't amount to any answers either. Man, there is no break or breather. There's no time for this smug frustration. I say everyone's a power station. I will light the way. But we gotta say, we can save the world a little every day. Hey there, polar bear, I know this much is true. There are so many, many, many things that we can do. If you don't go and lay it on the line, what will we tell tomorrow when tomorrow says we have this time? Well, I know we're gonna find a way. I know we're gonna light the way. And I know we're gonna make it, but we gotta say, we can save the world today and every day. Today and every day and every day.
Very nice. Welcome to the Unitarian Universal Church of Utica. I'm Dave Jones.
Welcome to the Unitarian Universal Church of Utica. I am Dave Jones, only one of the newest members of the Climate Action Team, and you are welcome. Whether you're visiting for the first time or have been here many years, you are welcome here. Whatever faith you have known, if any, you are welcome here. Whoever you are, whoever you love, you are welcome here. We are invited to bring our whole selves to this worship service, our doubts as well as our convictions. The pain and joy we have known, our longing for connection and understanding, every part of you is welcome. We have a couple of announcements. First, a quote. Mike. Oh, Dave. All right. Announcements first. Ken Drake.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm set up in the nursery across the hall. We have the petition that the Climate Action Team has approved to send to the Kirkland Town Planning Board. Please sign if you haven't done so already. And then I also have on the table some things set out for letters of moral conscience. Ask about that, please. Thank you.
Second announcements by, Deb Hagenbach.
Hello. On next week, April 28th, we will have a peer-to-peer orientation session for newcomers or visitors. There will be a number of people from the membership committee participating. It really will be a free exchange of ideas and questions and just a little chat about our Unitarian Universalist Church in Utica. So please, those of you who are interested, Stay after church. We promise we won't take long, and you can come and go as you please, and hope to see you next week.
And Jack, come on up.
Hi, I'm Jack Pendrak, and I just want to give a thank you to the congregation. Our pledge drive is now up to $89,605. We have a revised goal of $90,000, so we're almost there. Thank you very much. We've increased significantly from last year, and it's because of the it's because of all of you and your generosity. Thank you.
Any further announcements? Thank you.
So before we have the call to worship, I have a couple of service edits. I'm going to ask Rick Werner and Brenda to also extinguish the chalice, as well as light it. And I want to send a shout out to Roberta Matthews, who is probably on the Zoom. She became ill during the night and texted me this morning. And so I am going to attempt to be Roberta to open. It's selections from the Oneness Declaration by Irvin Laszlo and Georgi Szabo. I am part of the world. The world is not outside of me, and I am not outside of the world. The world is in me, and I am the world. I am in the world. I am part of nature, and nature is part of me. I am what I am in my communication and communion with all living things. I am an irreducible and coherent whole with the web of life on this planet. I acknowledge my role and responsibility in evolving a planetary consciousness in me and by example in others around me. This is my right as well as my obligation or duty as a conscious member of a conscious species on a precious but now critically endangered planet.
I don't know which of you wants to light and which of you wants to read.
Oh, we've been practicing for
You've been
okay.
She made that up. That'll work. Good morning, this is Brenda Maris, I'm Rick Werner. And ecologist Baba Diom said, in the end we will conserve only what we love. We will love only what we understand, and we will understand only what we are taught. We gather today to celebrate Earth Day, to express our deepest devotion to all life, and to recommit to protecting what we love. Thanks.
Still, be as quiet as a pond before sunrise, so still that when a rainbow trout fishing for flies eyes a mosquito, you hear it swim. Be still. Be still, be as quiet as shadows at noon. So still, that when a red-winged blackbird dropping a seed disturbs a chipmunk, you hear it blink. Be still. Be still. Open your ears and your eyes and your mind. Open your heart and your spirit might find a peace on this earth, the one home we share, where we drink the same water, breathe the same air. Be still, be as quiet as a forest at midnight. So still, that when the temperature drops, freezing the sand in the white pines, you hear it snap. Be still. Be still, be as quiet as a cloud in the sky. So still, that when the rainstorm is over, moisture is moving, evaporating, you hear it rise. Be still. Open your ears and your eyes and your mind. Open your heart and your spirit might find a peace on this earth, the one home we share, where we drink the same water, breathe the same air. Be still, be as quiet as if 6 feet under. So still, that when the tree you once planted sends out its roots and feeds on your body, you hear it grow. Be still. Be still.
Good morning, and welcome to Together Time. My name is Stephanie Markham, and today I am going to read you a love letter to a tree by Reverend Kelly Dignan. This is a story with no pictures today, so please use your imaginations. The letter spoke of the tree's strength, resilience, and the beauty it brought to the garden. Alex marveled at the way the tree sheltered birds and insects, creating a harmonious ecosystem. Carefully folding the letter, Alex nestled it into a small nook in the tree's bark. "This is for you, my dearest friend," they whispered, feeling a warm connection to their living friend, the tree. One stormy night, a powerful wind blew through town. The next morning, Alex rushed outside to find a small branch had been cracked by the storm. Sadness washed over Alex, but determination sparkled in their eyes. With care and creativity, Alex worked with their parent to gather rope and other supplies. Together, the two mended the branch. You protect me from the sun, and now I'll protect you, Alex whispered. Lo and behold, after several months, the wood on the small branch fused back together, and a new leaf sprouted. Through all the seasons, the bond between Alex and the tree grew stronger. Their friendship became a beacon of love and resilience, teaching everyone that even the smallest act of kindness can make a big difference. That was a love letter to a tree by the Reverend Kelly Dignan. Thanks.
Move this way down. I'm Sally Carmen, long, long time member of the church. And I wanted to talk about why we give to the church and why I especially give to the church. And it's because the members of this church care about people and about the earth. The two are intimately intertwined. For one thing, we support the Climate Action Team, which is presenting this service today, which in conjunction with the Rotary Club and the City of Utica, will have planted 100 trees in inner city Utica by the end of this year. Much thanks to Barbara. We know climate change affects those less fortunate more than others because of the pollution near their homes and for many other reasons. Thus, we support the social justice team. Our members were well ahead of their time when this building was constructed in 1978. It was built with a lower ceiling, with tri-pane windows, with inner walls with a greater distance from the outside wall to allow for more insulation. And we hope to still be continuing to improve our water and air heating systems with more efficient technology. May we continue as individuals and as a group to mitigate and adapt to climate changes that affect all of us. Thank you.
We will take the offering, and while we're taking the offering, we have the privilege of listening to them, Callum Toyotella, singing, and the rest of the crowd of us singing behind her.
This precious web of life on earth, inheritance of all at birth, has every blessing freely given to you. It is a fragile holy ground, a treasure to be handed down, or overflowing hearts sing hallelujah. Still so strong, now we are here to bring that question to you. Our faith is strong, we face the truth that climate change needs no more proof. Will our descendants share our hallelujah? Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
be that we need. Now consequences threaten to undo ya. For careless ways we'll pay the cost. If beauty of the earth is lost, our broken hearts will sing no hallelujah. 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 Because this planet cannot wait, this city must not hesitate. Our quality of life, we're trusting to ya. We'll work together to survive so we can keep the earth alive. Our hopeful hearts declare.
As you might have guessed, I'm trying to set a mood here. And as you read in the theme, we're starting with love, then grief. Because when we love something, grief comes. And grief leads to hope. Believe it or not, I'm going to try to make that case. And action. So the next hymn is unfamiliar to us. Melissa is going to play it at least once through. But I promise you, the tune is more intuitive than many of our UU hymns. And the words were written many years ago, but to me, they seemed absolutely on target. So if you'll turn in the gray hymnals to page 173, and I actually don't have a hymnal,
so I'm gonna grab one somewhere.
Oh, yes, I'll look with you.
Okay.
Thanks.
In the branches of the forest, in the petals of the marigold, on the shoulder of the mountain, in the vastness of the sea, you will find a brooding sadness over all the ancient watershed. You will see it written plainly on the wind and in the sand. There's a blight upon the mountain, there's a sickness of the evening sky, and we ask the age-old question, can we purge us of this sin? Can we save the little nestling from the venom of the cankerworm? Can we clear the look of anguish from the soft eyes of the doe? In the thunder, new commandments sound a warning through the wilderness. Let the forest be untainted, let the streams be undefiled, let the waters of this river, as they flow down to the ocean, be as sweet as in the old days when the mountain stood alone.
My name is Kim Bywater. I'd like to read a meditation from the UUA. Sit and settle your mind and body in any way that feels supported. You might close your eyes or lower your gaze. Notice your breath, how it comes and goes naturally. Feel yourself settle even more deeply. Pose this question to your heart: what do I love? Simply ask and notice whatever arises. Make space for anything and everything. Pause. Deepen this inquiry by asking, what is too important to me to lose or forget? Keep listening, honoring whatever arises. Pause. As something clear emerges, appreciate your connection, your commitment, your devotion. Pause. And now in your imagination, offer a gesture or phrase to express your love. Pause. Gently come back to the present moment. You might want to wiggle your toes or your fingers and open your eyes if they have been closed.
We gather at this Earth Day service to honor our love and to acknowledge our grief for Earth and all beings, knowing that as we do, we will be more prepared to act for change. We are living in a time when anyone awake is breaking. We have newly coined phrases for it: echo anxiety, climate grief, pre-traumatic stress disorder. When you love something or someone so much, and your very survival depends upon it, of course you're frightened when you see it under attack. But this love is strong enough to break through the worry. It can shake you out of your despair and propel you to action. That's the case I hope to make to you today. Grief can be a transformative process. It's a practice that will force us out of our steady state, our normal way of acting and being in the world. People can't fix problems they don't confront. We mourn so we can come out on the other side. It hurts because it's supposed to. Turning off the pain would mean turning off our humanity. Climate grief is not an illness to cure. It is a condition to live with. But then again, isn't all grief? When we suppress our grief for the world, we're also suppressing our compassion. If we see grief as a reflection of our love, it can help us to acknowledge and honor this pain. Joanna Macy says, We have a longing for coming home to the sacredness of our belonging to the earth, to the living body of earth, with joy of serving at every step. I make it sound easy, she says, but we can't do it alone. Just hearing the news of what's happening every day on the planet, she says, I can't do it alone. I'm not supposed to. Even looking at it requires that we reach out to each other and take each other's arm. And I can tell you how I feel, and you can tell me how you feel, and we listen. The very steps we need to take bring us to the point of it, which is our collective nature, our non-separateness. This is part of it all. Reconnecting, I'm still quoting Joanna Macy, by the way, reconnecting is one of the most important things we can do for our planet. As we work to reconnect with ourselves, we can then begin to reconnect radically with other people, animals, insects, trees, rivers, fungi, and the larger world around us. We can learn to trust, to create community, to do meaningful work in a world that can sometimes feel hopeless. Preparatory to action, we can be responsive to the needs of the world out of a natural response to shared grief. Our meditation today by Kim Bywater helped each of us to connect with what we love. What could the future hold if love were at the center of ourselves, of our relationships, of our actions, of our world? If we reimagine a world of justice with love at the center, we cultivate communities of care where all beings can thrive. In her essay, But the Greatest of These is Love, Mary Aeneas Hegler says, there's many different schools of thought about how we should feel about climate change. If I'm honest with myself, she continues, what I truly feel is love. I don't mean any simple, sappy kind of love. I mean living, breathing, heart-beating love. This love is not a noun. It is an action verb. We love the blue sky with the bright air. We love the big blue sky with the air we breathe. The spring sweetness of carrots left in the ground. The warm life-giving sun, the beauty and wildness of storms, the look on a child's face, and so much more. Love holds us together. We protect what we love. So where does hope come from? Real good, useful hope has little to do with positive news. It is profoundly linked with action, both ours and that of others alongside us. There's only one way to earn hope, and that's rolling up our sleeves. In her book, Hope in the Dark, Rebecca Solnit argues that love is not a lottery ticket you can sit on the sofa and clutch, feeling lucky. It's something restless, alive. It's an act you break down doors with in an emergency, she writes. So I get hope from the actions that I do, and I suspect you do also, real actions that you can see the result of. But I get hope from the actions of others too, like weather forecasters. Don't laugh. For decades, I've been waiting for weather forecasters, local and national, to mention climate change and the hotter, wetter, windier weather with multiple wildfires. I've talked back to them and said, why aren't you saying this? And now they mention it daily. Have you heard about the Toyota water engine? Water serves as a source of hydrogen powering fuel cells. The process involves electrolysis, where water molecules are split into hydrogen and oxygen using an electric current, hopefully from solar. The only emission is water vapor. I've printed the article and posted it on the bulletin board in the back by the bathrooms if you want to read about it. Have you heard about the climate initiatives of Linde, the global conglomerate? I used to be suspicious of them. Maybe still I am a little bit. They believe that issues over the long-term energy availability and future climate change is one of, will only continue to intensify. Addressing the issues surrounding climate change is one of the highest priorities, says Linde, around the world. Amongst other things, they are researching hydrogen advantages, krypton coating for window insulation, and emissions reductions too numerous to mention here. Look at linde.com to see more. There's more industries that are doing things too, but before I finish the list of actions by others, I want to mention Environmental Defense Fund. Maybe Bill Gazzetano's on the Zoom, because somewhere in the 80s, Bill Gazzetano mentioned EDF to me, and I looked at it, and I started supporting it because I was so excited. Some of the things that they did and are doing and have just done are amazing. For example, they hire college graduates and place them inside industries to reduce the energy that the industry uses. They pay their first year salary. Most of the time, in fact, I don't know of any case it hasn't happened, that the interns saved the company so much money that the company then hired the intern to continue. It's a great program. Recently, they put into orbit methane SAT. You may have seen it on the TV news. Methane SAT. It's already in orbit, detecting and documenting methane emissions from industry, from mines, from farms, and wherever else. Methane has 80 times the heat trapping potential of carbon dioxide during the first 20 years after it's released. You can't fix emissions that you do not know about. You can't know about or prove emissions without data. I'll bet the engineers who are working on all of these projects are hopeful. They know what they've done, and they know it made a difference. But much of the real hope for you and for me comes from actions that we and our communities, yes, even our church community, take. When I take real actions, I feel more hopeful, and I suspect you do too. In addition, others see you and either join in or follow your example. I know I rode a Honda Helix for years, and everywhere I went, they'd ask me, how much mileage do you get? Well, about 70, sometimes 72, and I'd show them my big trunk where you could put things. You'd be surprised how many people look at your example. I have some real action suggestions for you, but I'm sure you'll think of your own and already have thought of your own. First, act as if you are part of all sentient life, because you are. Really reconnect. When I read Overstory by Richard Powers and other recent tree books, when I visited Longwood Gardens in Winterthur in Pennsylvania, I really felt interaction with those great, tall, strong trees. And it stayed with me. When I look at trees around me, I feel as if we and they and all sentient life are working together to help heal the earth. There's real power and hope in that. Plant trees and join with others planting trees. I know, I have to take this with me. I don't think I can. I'll just...
Now I can't even put it back in.
Let me give you the portable. Here, I got you.
Can you fix this stuff?
Yes, I can.
Technology has never been my middle name. But when members of the climate action team, I know, I'm trying to set it down so you can see our logo. Residents who get a tree request help caring for the tree. They request a pail. Matt Cavalieri drills tiny holes in the bottom of these, not too many, because we recommend that they put 5 gallons of water twice a week, unless it's pouring rain during that week, and fill it. And because it comes out slowly, the roots are able to absorb it all. It doesn't like zoom away. We bought compostable mats, which go around the tree and keep the weeds from growing. And I found nails, and my late partner's John's, they're rusty. He always saved rusty nails. It's a perfect use for them. So we put a nail on each end of this so it won't blow away. It's not hard. You could put it in with a rock, but I take this cute little hammer and do it, and we do it. And we zip tie the pail to the tree loosely. It doesn't hurt it, and it keeps it from blowing away. We've even supplied hoses to people who didn't need one, and if you have an extra hose, let me know. And, oh, now are these gonna fight with each other, Jeff?
Yeah, you can just press the button until the green light goes out.
So the point of my short story, hopefully short, is we bring hope to the homeowner, and the homeowner feels hope because they are actually important in the health of the tree. And I'll bet they teach other people too. Consider, you're gonna laugh at this one, but I even told my neighbor yesterday and he was not, he said he'd go for gray. Consider painting roofs and other sky-facing things white to reflect the heat of the sun back into space. They've been doing it for years in Florida. It ought to be done everywhere. You've probably seen the school buses with the white roofs. I suppose they're white to keep the kids inside comfortable in the hot weather, but frankly, it's also pushing the heat back into space. Many towns are actually painting their highways white. And you know how many miles of highways we have in this country? If we paint them all white, that's a lot of heat going back into space. So don't laugh, or you can. Buy local food when you can. Sign up for community solar. No money up front, just buying electricity from a solar facility, but paying and still using National Grid as the carrier. It's cheaper and no carbon emissions. The climate team has been researching alternative energy choices and plans to provide a report in the near future. My goal was today, but obviously I didn't make it. But I think we'll have it by next week, and we'll be putting it in the newsletter, on the bulletin board, and maybe we'll even print something up. Because some of our members have been asking, what should we do? Which solar thing should we go with? Talk with people about climate, because we can't fix what we don't talk about. Meet people where they are. Ask open-ended questions. Many people don't even recognize what's happening or really know for sure what's happening. But be cautious. Connection outweighs facts. I started researching climate change in 1978. I wanted to see if it was really real or if this is a crock, whatever it is. By 1982, I had become so concerned and knew that it was real and that it was important. And I told every human that I saw all the facts. And guess what? Facts do not interest people. Facts do not change hearts. What I think changes hearts is emotion, morality, and morality is part of religion. The goal is conversation, not conquest. One recent study found that second-order beliefs, what we think others think about a topic, actually is key to forming our own beliefs. So showing climate is important to you will help others think about it, maybe even change their hearts and minds eventually. Plus, you'll make it easier for them to talk to other people about climate as well. Start with just one conversation. Donate to a larger environmental organization. Personal acts are hopeful and great, but we must act globally as well. Joanna Macy, one of my heroes, you might have guessed, said, "We have a choice. Do we want to give up and surrender to the great unraveling? Or do we want to join those who are working for a sustainable future?" Hope is not a happy accident. Hope is a choice empowered by action.
Love is an action word. Thank you so much, Barb. I feel like Elvis. Our closing words today are brought to us by Reverend Kelly Diggin. She's actually the co-director of Unitarian Universalist Ministry for Earth. And I just want to tell you a little bit about them. Their mission actually is to be a seedbed, offering spiritual grounding and education to cultivate deep practices of earth care and intersectional environmental justice. And they do this through three things. They provide resources, like some of the things that I'm actually going to be reading to you. They also provide actions that we can do together. And finally, they offer gatherings. And because they're earth-based, their calendar is actually a lunar calendar. So the gatherings are every full moon. The next full moon is Tuesday. So if you're interested, you can go online. Again, it's the Unitarian Universalist Ministry for Earth. Find the link and join in the gathering. And to go to back to our closing words from Reverend Dignan. In the presence of the boundless mysteries of the cosmos, we gather in deep gratitude and awe. We give thanks for the unfolding wonders of the natural world, the intricate dance of ecosystems, the resilience of life, and the profound interconnectedness that weaves through the tapestry of existence. We acknowledge the urgent call for earth care and climate justice.
I made a last-minute change of splitting the reading and the benediction with the chalice lighting, and then we just weren't up to speed yet.
Oh, I need to do this too. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we meet again.
This is a continuation of Reverend Dignan's reading. We acknowledge the urgent call for earth care and climate justice. Help us imagine a future, a flourishing for all ages. Align our actions with the rhythms of nature and the principles of justice. Grant us the courage to confront the challenges of our time with compassion, seeking justice for those most affected by environmental degradation.
in this shared journey. May we be guided by love and the sacred energy that unites us all. May we embody the principles of care, gratitude, and a profound love for the intricate web of life. Amen.
This is Jack Pendrak again. Jeff asked me to make a another impromptu announcement. Due to the generosity of one of our members, we have now met our goal of $90,000. So thank you very much, everyone.
This is where we are called to be.